growing up in India, my mother was my main storyteller. She'd make these balls of rice and yogurt and mangoes and tell me these fascinating stories about kings, queens, goddesses, gods. And I learned so much about values, about good and bad, right and wrong from these stories. But today, media is the main storyteller in our life. Electronic digital storyteller that teaches us so much about who we are and the world around us. When I first came to the US, I had this impression that it would be like the Hollywood films and Baywatch episodes that I had seen. So I had imagined that everybody would be wearing bikinis and running into the sunset on these fabulous beaches. But that's not how things were when I landed in central Pennsylvania. Nor was it that people were wearing cowboy hats and riding horses like in Western movies when I landed in Texas. These incidents showed me that media and popular culture, they shape our ideas about our identities, about culture, about race, ethnicity, genders. Some people even call media a third parent. Just like parents, media is sometimes used as a babysitter. And also, we learn so much from media, just like we learn so much from our parents. And to illustrate this example, when I came home from work one day, my son, he was suddenly speaking in Korean. Nobody in our house speaks Korean. I've never taken him to Korean lessons. So I said, "How are you speaking Korean?" And he said, "Mom, there's an app online and I've been studying on my own." And next week, he was speaking in Japanese. So that shows you the power of technology for information, for education. But media access is something that we shouldn't take for granted, because really it's a privilege. When you think about countries around the world where there are authoritarian governments, lots of times they restrict media access. Even in prisons like this, inmates' access to media is heavily restricted. And places like India, there are remote villages where there's no electricity to charge your phone. So parents are very regular in sending their kids to school where there's solar energy to charge the phone. I think that's a great reason to send kids to school. Even within a generation, the amount of time that we've spent with media has drastically increased. So if you add up the time that's spent with digital media, with television, newspapers, radio, and so on, when you add all these up, really the number is enormous. I want you to guess how many hours an average American spends with media today. Show me with your fingers what your estimate is. Not 6, not 10. Actually, you need both your hands and a couple of toes as well, because the number is actually 12. 12 hours. That's more than the time spent with family, with work, at school, even sleeping. So when you're consuming so much of media, it's important to ask about your media diet, the quality and quantity of what you're consuming. Just like we should care about the food we eat, the air that we breathe, and the water that we drink, we need to care about the quality and quantity of the stories we consume. Because they shape our beliefs, they shape our worldview, they shape our reality. You know, junk food cannot be the main food that you have. It can be a guilty indulgence once in a while. You need to also make sure that inspirational, educational, informational content is the main diet that you're following. It's okay to have occasional indulgences, just like junk food. If you're consuming a lot of meaningless violence or things that are not very factual or quite biased and media stereotypes, then we have to really think about how that might affect you. I know kids who have gambling just from non-stop texting. And there are parents who spend a lot of money to send their kids to detoxification camps for video game addiction. So really, there has to be balance and moderation, just like with any other diet. And sometimes it's important to take a break when things get very heated on my Facebook page, I always step away and go look at some cat memes, and they just lighten up my day, because sometimes it can be overwhelming and exhausting. About 15 years ago or so, I started my research on media stereotypes, media violence, and at that time I was focused much more on learning about how these shape our biases, how they lead to dehumanization. It can lead to desensitization, objectification, and biases. Some of these biases show up in everyday conversations even. I remember going to my first American wedding, and the person next to me, he asked me where I was from. I said, India. And then he started asking me all these questions about tigers and elephants. Went on and on. Have you ridden tigers? Is that how you go to school? Are they in your backyard? Do you pet them? It was hilarious. And I felt like saying, I'm not Mowgli from the Jungle Book and singing, bare necessities, simple bare necessities. I mean, that was a hilarious example. But, sometimes you feel you're being a stereotype in that conversation rather than a complete person. And sometimes the effects are much more extreme. So it could lead to discrimination in hiring and promotion, could lead to wrongful convictions. It can even lead to death and violence against people. So these things are really serious and have to be studied. But also, media is a powerful tool. And just like with any tool, it can be used for good or for bad. So the question is, how can media be used as a tool for positive, as a source for good, to bring positivity? How can we use the power of media to reduce biases and stigma, to bring people together, to connect groups together? Once I started asking these questions, the type of research that I started doing was quite different. So when we showed participants counter stereotypes to diverse portrayals, to positive portrayals of minority groups. So when I say counter stereotypes, these are really those images or stories or characters that challenge existing stereotypes. And when you present these to audiences, especially of minority groups, they become much more open to having positive attitudes towards this group. And even at the implicit or subconscious level, we find that emotions such as admiration and respect increase, and hatred and contempt decrease. And those who see such images are more likely to support policies like affirmative action for minority groups. Not only does this have a positive effect on majority groups and how they view minority groups, but minority groups themselves, when they see positive portrayals of their groups, their self-esteem increases, their ethnic pride increases, their self-concept becomes much more positive. I felt that this is important to take to the society, to media creators, to media consumers, and to let them know why it's important to have inclusive, positive storytelling. Just like one stick is easy to break, but when you have a bundle of sticks, there is strength in that unity. Keeping this principle in mind, I co-founded Media Rise. Media Rise is for promoting meaningful media. And I bring together media educators with filmmakers, journalists, parents, teachers, community leaders, all of whom are committed to this idea of positive, inclusive storytelling. And we celebrate positive storytellers, we invest in media ideas that are for peace, for social justice, for sustainability. And in this way, we support one another. And through Media Rise, I've had the opportunity to take this message to different communities around the world. One such community was a mosque in London, and I did this workshop for them, and we were talking about how their portrayals are in the media. The majority of people in the group were black Muslims, so they started telling me that they were very unhappy with the way that they're portrayed in the media. I remember this one gentleman with a little boy who said, I'm afraid to go to the movies, I'm afraid to switch on the television, or to open the newspaper because of the ways in which my group is presented as criminal, as terrorist, as violent all the time. It was really disheartening because this person was basically avoiding media completely because of how their group is being portrayed. So then we started changing the conversation, asking the question, how would you like your group to be portrayed in the media? And this to answers to those where we would like to be portrayed as fun, as sociable, artistic, creative, different from the current stereotypes we see in the media. And this was really refreshing because this was changing their ideas of how they could be. And they were reimagining a different media world. And some of them actually started their own blog after this conversation that portrayed Muslims and blacks in a different way. So these experiences show us that there is hope. We can change the media, and in a world that's filled with hate and violence and negativity, we can be agents of change. We can elevate the discourse. The first step, we need to recognize biases and stereotypes in the main media. For instance, we need to ask questions like, why is it that Asians are always represented as geeks or martial artists? And why is it that Latinas are always represented as maids or hypersexual objects?
Once we ask these questions, we're already changing the conversation.
Another thing that we can do is build in some unplugged spaces, times into our lives. You know, at least while crossing the road, look left and right before you cross. Or meal times can be devised free times. Because sometimes I've gone to dinners where everybody is on their phone or a device in front of them and wondering, why am I invited to this dinner? Nobody's talking here. Make sure that anything that you share is factual and is based on facts. It's based on something that's verifiable. And make sure that something is not, you know, alternative facts or fake. Basically, something like 30 pounds can be lost in 1 week, or if you click on this email, you'll win $1 million. Clearly, it's not credible. You don't want to be sharing such things. Yeah. Another thing that we can do is protest or boycott media that consistently portray groups in negative ways, especially minority groups. And this can be done by writing to the authors, it can be done by having protests. For instance, Arab Americans organized a protest when Aladdin was about to be released because of the ways in which their groups were portrayed as ruthless and barbaric. And they were actually successful because Disney changed some of the lyrics. So there's power in citizens coming together like that. Another thing to do is to include non-traditional media, alternative media sources into your media diet. Maybe filmmakers from around the world, or read up authors, maybe indigenous authors that you might not have otherwise considered. If you have some great ideas of your own of using media for good, amplify your voice by connecting with others like you. Maybe create a network yourself. Or if there are existing alternative or community-based media, you can support them through your time, your donation, to your participation.
For instance, there's Latinitas. That's an organization that creates an online magazine for and by Latina girls. Or Silk Road Rising, which is another group that provides alternative videos of Muslims and Arabs.
So these are great examples. You could also create your networks for meaningful media, or join existing networks like Media Rise to support positive inclusive storytelling. I'd say that it's important to have a nourishing media diet, one that nourishes your mind, body, and bowl, which is soul. And media then becomes a source of inspiration, of elevation, of awe, of compassion, of empathy. And it's being used with wisdom, purpose, and meaning. And when each of us start doing this and others follow suit, then there's a ripple effect of positivity. And several such ripples can lead to a wave of positivity. And such ways to create an alternative media world, one where media is used much more mindfully, much more meaningfully, and much more inclusively. Thank you.